Hello? I'm standing here, man. There's a lot of people I could be doing business with other than you, Howard. You're falling apart. You're looking like a fool out here in the Diamond District. You're looking through fucking fish? Come on, man. I gave you 8 years of my life, and you can't even fucking talk to me and then look me in the eyes? Man the fucking man?
Holy shit, I'm gonna come.
And fuck you, man. I'm finished with this shithole.
Roses are red. Howie's a degenerate bum.
Holy shit, I'm gonna come.
This is Uncut Gem spoilers.
That is amazing.
Wow.
That's poetry right there.
It's been a while for the movie trivia game. Last time we did this, what was the last movie trivia, Pap?
It was Mouse Hunt, hosted by Stevie.
It's a great movie. That's all I'm saying. It's a great movie.
And Stevie chose that as like a Christmas movie, or what was that? That was...
And it came out in February.
It's a Christmas movie. Okay, I'll put it this way. It's a Christmas movie that can be enjoyed at any time of the year.
There are two gorecore picks on the board right now, Mouse Hunt and The Ring, for me on the Schneid. So it's been a while.
Yeah, so we during that time, we've just been doing like a bunch of Return of the King episodes. So that's kind of what we've been up to for, what, like 2 months? It was like 7 episodes. So a whole pivot happened in between then. I was going to do The Matrix after I had won Mouse Hunt. And that time has passed. Matrix, I don't even think is streaming anymore. I just couldn't bear to like pay money for it. And I was... not in a mood to even watch it again at all. It's if you've seen it, you probably can guess why. It's just not, it's not very fun. It wouldn't be fun to talk about either.
Well, for those not behind the scenes, Mikey, you had a rare double pivot, actually. You picked something else.
Well, we were on a Robert Pattinson high, so I had pivoted because we had all just watched The Batman, so I was like, oh, I'll pivot to Good Time. Because I really like that movie, and I guess we haven't done that, have we?
No.
So I was going to do that, but Corey, super fan of Pattinson, was like, I want to do that one. So I'll do the other dirtbag movie, and I chose Uncut Gems, giving Corey a good time when he...
Yeah, whenever he went. Something that apparently you're allowed to trade.
Get bullied out of, really.
There's more, though, happening, too, behind the scenes. There's a lot of... mechanisms turning. Pappy, Lord of the Rings used to be a Christmas project. We're staring down April, but our episodes are going to be so long. People don't even know. Mm-hmm. I hope they think that's a good thing. Like, this is the longest we've ever covered a movie.
A lot of bickering.
Long and wide. Girthy Viggo Mortensen episodes coming at you for Return of the King.
Yeah, but that's kind of what I've been up to, just working on Lord of the Rings shit. We got a Batman podcast, should be coming out soon.
Episode 400, the Batman podcast.
Yeah, it's out.
A lot of content on the way, but right now we're trying to reboot the movie trivia game because it's just been so long. So I'm here to do that, and I just got done watching Uncut Gems. So that's... the movie for this week. Yeah, opening question. We'll go west to east, and if you're going to place a high-stakes bet, what is the professional sport you would feel most confident betting on? So, Howard, he's betting a lot on the NBA in this movie. I don't watch a lot of sports, but I would not feel confident betting on NBA games as much as Howard is feeling confident. Am I the westest? Because Corey's not here.
I think you are the weakest, so. Yeah.
Mikey, your host from Chicago. I would feel most confident betting on strictly Liverpool soccer. I would just be like, Liverpool's probably going to score 3 goals and they're going to win. That would be as much as knowledge as I could.
That's a good bet.
Possibly muster up for any particular sport. Pap?
This is Pappy recording in Kalamazoo. I'm not the next Weestus, but I kind of float in between Weestus and Eustus. I think I've told the story on pod before, but I'll just tell it again. I remember one time, so I lived in Colorado, I would place bets for Stevie. I was like the booker in the
it
restaurant
was great.
For Stevie. I remember one time I hit a really big parlay, like, I don't know why I asked Stevie that, but it was fun and it was illegal. I used like a European site that was very shady. You had to get your money out in Bitcoin. So it was super confusing. But I hit a really big parlay at like 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and then yada yada yada, it was 4 o'clock in the morning, and I placed a bet on Eastern European women's volleyball. I was like, huh, what just happened back there? How did I just spend 8 hours gambling? So I try and avoid that, Mikey. If I had to pick, probably the outcome of like an NBA best of seven series. I feel like Howard's onto something when he says they want the stars in there. You know what I mean? I feel like that's a good bet usually.
The NBA doesn't want the Sixers to win. They got fucking, there's no money in that. You understand? The refs know that.
They want stars. Stars get a fucking ring.
Do you think that line was like intentional? Like they had to get that? I don't know. Like Kevin Garnett was like, say this line.
Was this movie blessed by the NBA? Are they like on board with this, or are they?
Don't they have to be?
I mean, there's a lot of NBA footage being shown in this.
Yeah, don't they have to be on board with it?
I have no idea.
They could have been paid for the rights and then hated the final product. I don't really know what the story is. They're probably pretty mum on it, I would guess.
It's ABC, right? So it's Mickey Mouse who owns the rights to this. I wonder if he knew he was going to be in a movie where come through Adam Sandler's asshole to start off with.
Who's next week's is Josh?
Sure. This is Josh from Goshen. I am not really a person that's bitten by the gambling bug, luckily. So I probably wouldn't. I don't really relate to Howard when it comes to like his sports betting. I think that's like some of his stupidest stuff he does in this movie. But I will still answer this question for you, Mikey. I will say I'd feel best, most comfortable betting on Tom Brady.
So real quick, according to IndieWire.com, the Safdie brothers did not have the licensing agreement of the NBA. They used it under fair use.
Ooh.
Similar to how Spoilers uses all of our clips under fair use.
Josh, that's a cop-out. Everybody knows.
Wait, Josh, did you just say you don't gamble?
What?
I'm sorry, I was looking over my stuff.
I want to know what Mikey's advice was there. What everybody knows.
I was going to say, if you're going to match up Aaron Rodgers and Tom Brady, you're going to take Tom Brady every day.
All day.
You have to trust someone that actually loves their family.
You do.
It makes a big difference. It's kind of like what this movie's about.
Why did you walk into that one, Brett?
Well, I didn't do anything. Just typical, some people projecting, some people are bullies, trash talking.
I just like Tom Brady. I think he's got a good mind for the game, okay?
Yeah, he wanted to come back
he's
one
really
more
good at
year
cheating.
And just stick it
Tommy
to Aaron
Four
Rodgers.
Names is a great person, okay, Brett?
Yeah.
Like, not this year, Aaron. I'm coming back.
Yeah, he loves his family so much, he can only spend 42 days with them.
That's a fair point, actually.
That's all he needs to recharge. He's good
he
for the year.
He calls his mother, Brett. He calls his mother.
I'm sure he sees them at the end of a very long day. Stevie, what do you feel confident? What's
Premier
sport?
League soccer. Chelsea, to be exact. I feel like I know that team pretty well. I usually... Parlays are incredibly hard to hit. And Howie placing to win the opening tip on a parlay is insane. Because, I mean, all it takes is one leg to fall and you're done.
Yeah, parlays all over town.
Yeah, and so the last parlay I hit decently well was a plus 1,500 Chelsea versus Norwich. I took over 2.5 goals total. Chelsea to cover the spread of minus one. Chelsea to have six or more shots on target, Chelsea to win the corner spread, and Chelsea to be winning at halftime, and all those hit.
It's pretty crazy that this movie came out in 2019, because I feel like during the pandemic, like this wave of like at-home gambling hit, and now it's like every other commercial is for like DraftKings
FanDuel
or something like that. It's insane.
Because this takes place like, what, 2010 or something?
2012.
Because I was like, where is she going on the helicopter at the end? But she's probably flying to, like, Atlantic City.
Is that why the bet was $155,000? Because it cost $10,000 for the helicopter?
I thought the Keith Stanfield took his cut out of it.
Yeah.
Before.
That was 10. They already took the 10 off that.
Yeah.
160, because you only gave him 165.
Oh. It was supposed to be 175, and then it was 165, and then it was 155.
Now it just keeps losing.
She showed up and paid for the helicopter in cash, just handed him $10,000.
Give him two of these stacks.
Brett, are you taking the Packers? Is that what you're betting on?
You said professional sport. I'd probably go NFL or, I don't know, UFC. I had a parlay a few weeks ago, but I just picked the favorites.
See, that sounds so dangerous to bet on.
Yeah, it's a one punch can change everything. Yeah, I mean, I probably would have felt a lot more confident about 7 years ago when I knew a lot more about it. But
what percent chance is it, Brett, to like the parlay he puts on Kevin Garnett and the Celtics? What do you think percent chance that is to like hit all of it?
I mean, really low. I got to think, just like Stevie said, 50, you already take 50% off with the tip off.
Yeah, the tip bet is insane to me.
Let's say it's 10 or 10%, right? Let's say
it's more than that. I mean, it's less than
that.
Because
it goes from 155,000 to a million, right?
1.2 or something.
Okay. So it sounds like about 9 to 1, 10 to 1, something like that.
What they show in this movie is that sliver of times that parlays work out. In reality, the other 7%. 95% of the
they don't
time,
work.
You just you lose on the tip and you're just deflated and
not 93.2.
Yeah, but if you win on the tip, you're riding that high. Keep it going.
Yeah, you're riding that 2.5% happy. That's what the wise guys do.
Like parlays are fun for like $5-$10 bets, especially if you're running like
that's all I do. Yeah, I don't bet a lot of money.
If you're running like five legs, you know, $5-$10, but $40,000 on like a six.
Yeah, you're like throwing your money away.
On a six leg parlay is just, whew, that's tough.
And on the opening tip, it's like, what if one guy just doesn't want to jump high this time? Like, granted, it's the playoffs, but it's like, play 100 games a year.
You're betting on the ref at that point. They might throw it poorly. The ref's athletic ability.
Did he toss it perfectly straight up, or was it?
And high enough that Kevin Garnett can even use his height and jumping ability to go get it. Like,
you're giving away all of Tim Donaghy's secrets here. Well.
Great reference, dude.
So let's get through this movie as quick as possible. Opening scene, a miner is kind of carried out of a really horrible looking mine. His leg is broken. And there's a couple other miners who use this opportunity as a distraction to go dig out a giant opal that is eventually bought by Howard Adam Sandler. We get a cool transition. Pappy, what do you think of this transition of the miners looking through this rock and ending up in Howard's colonoscopy?
It's so great because at first you think you're flying through like outer space and it looks super cool. Right, because it's super trippy in the colors, and there's weird fractals that you see in different colors. But then it somehow switches over to a colonoscopy, and it just tells you everything about the character, right? Like, Howard's an asshole. We're starting in his asshole. Josh, I think, didn't you do like this in an interview? You referenced this transition or something?
I did on the last time I job interviewed. I used a series of movies transitions that I thought were really creative, and I did use that. It was a big risk to use a scene about a colonoscopy in a meeting like that, but I landed it, so let's go.
It was a big gamble, Josh, but you hit it big. It was you went in with five videos. You had a five-video parlay.
I'm not an athlete. This is how I fucking win.
This is me. All right? I'm not a fucking athlete. This is my fucking way. This is how I win.
Yeah, I think it's great. Definitely a very cool transition, and it certainly ends up not where you expect it to be, where we're coming out of Howard's ass. Stevie, what'd you think of this soundtrack at the same time? This whole soundtrack is heavy on the synth.
Yeah, heavy synth. Like, I liked how the music matched with, like, kind of like Pappy said, like, going through the universe and, like, space and time. it just works. And to land on like in Howie's asshole is great for pretty much the rest of this movie. But I do like the heavy synth vibe, especially with it being set in 2012.
Stevie, would you say this is the most synth on the movie we've picked since Mikey the Thief?
I was thinking
Ooh.
Thief too, Brett.
In Vision Quest before that, maybe?
In Drive before that?
Well, Thief falls into the dirtbag genre.
I do love dirtbag cinema. Is I love it.
What do you mean by that, Stevie, when you say dirtbag cinema?
Dirtbag cinema, to me, is when our character that we're following around is an absolute piece of shit. That even though we are rooting for them time to time, they make decisions that just disgust us. Much like Moondog lighting millions of dollars on fire just for, you know, the shit of it. But that's what I mean by dirtbag cinema. The person we're following around is someone that in real life we would never get behind.
Fargo minus Marge equals dirtbag cinema.
Pretty much, yeah. Without Margie, we're in great dirtbag cinema territory.
Can I go back to the synth use for just a quick sec? There is this beat that this movie hits 6 to 10 times where the synth picks up into this really upbeat, dreamy...
It's like an explosion.
And it's, to me, it's pretty much all the best parts of the movie. They might be celebrating. They might be looking at an opal for the first time. I think right before Howie gets blasted and he's celebrating the win. And it's just like they're living in this like dream cinema for, how long is it, Stevie? Like 6 to 10 seconds.
Maybe 6 to 10 seconds, yeah.
It's just little tastes of like heaven or something in here.
It's pretty much we're feeling what the characters are feeling, and it's a great beat that this movie picks up. Good call, Josh.
So we cut to after Howard getting out of the doctor. He's getting slapped around by a bunch of Arno's bookies and his own store. They're kind of giving him a rough time in front of his like work associate, whose name is Damani, who's played by Lakeith Stanfield. And he's just kind of like a guy who like comes in and brings wealthy clientele to like check out the store and stuff. Like he's the guy that brought in KG to check out stuff. And he's just getting like embarrassed in front of his employees. Josh, who's the guy kind of slapping Howard around right now at this point?
I'm glad you tossed that to me because I have a quick note. It's Arnold's right hand like thug that he hires throughout the movie. What's actually his name in this? I don't know.
Phil.
Phil?
Yeah.
Just Phil.
Just Phil.
As if you were terrifying enough, his name's Phil. So that just fills you with dread for sure. But he like slaps him, and I noticed like when Howie / Adam Sandler is like kind of like that smarts from getting hit, he's like kind of touching the same exact spot that he later gets shot and killed. And I'm pretty sure that's like a purposeful nod. Obviously, this is a pretty tight script and they thought a lot of that out. But yeah, man, this guy is always lurking. And that's a big driver in this movie and a big part of the anxiety is that Arnold and Phil and there's like two or three other guys that are kind of there in the shadows too, are just on top of Howie all the time.
Arnold's friends here?
Yeah, I'm, yes, he told me you were waiting on me, so I'm sorry about that. I'm Howard.
You didn't bring him any water?
I'm good on this water. I don't really need water. Thank you anyway.
This is our own spring water. We're the first on the block to have that.
He's worried about spring water.
Your parents happy for you?
Yeah.
All right. So I gotta tell you, I'm in a bit of a rush. I'm not much time because I gotta get.
What did I tell you? I said no water. Didn't I tell you no water? I think it's in your best interest that you find some time for you and I.
Let me get you a second.
All right, we're on the same page.
I thought it was Eric Roberts for a while.
Phil?
It's not.
It looks just like him.
It does. And I think he's a scary looking guy, but it's not Eric Roberts. He was great, though. Yeah, I just could never remember what they were calling him. I don't remember what his name was, but he was great, and he certainly gets fed up with Howard over the course of the movie. He's really great at showing that and conveying it in like all of the scenes they're interacting together.
Phil's a loose cannon, man. He's a little scary. I love at the end when he's just super sweaty in that like that little in between area in the jewel shop, and I feel like Phil decides to kill him when Howard goes in on the Boston fat guy in the front row. I feel like at that moment Phil's like, okay, I'm gonna shoot this motherfucker. Like, that was the thing that was a little bit too far.
There's just a bunch of great weird goon guys just all around in this movie that are trying to hit up Howard for money. A lot of weird looking guys. Really great weird guy cast.
The guy who's like, he sells a fake Rolex to, or gives it, his like twin brother.
The twins.
That guy's a great like meme, just like lurking.
I don't think those guys are actors, by the way. I think they're just like two New York characters that they like pulled for this movie. If what I read is correct. Did you guys see that?
Half of this cast looks just like just regular people.
They acted like regular people too.
You didn't like it, Brett?
I just pointed out the jeweler at the beginning, who's not a real actor and he's a real jeweler, is not a good actor.
I don't hate that. He seems like a real person.
I could tell he wasn't an actor before I even looked it up.
Would you have been happier with an actor in that role?
Tom Holland?
Ooh.
I mean, not really.
What the hell?
Which guy?
The guy who quits.
The guy who gets roughed up by... Okay.
Yeah, the guy who quits and gets roughed up, I think. He actually apparently got like a $25,000 something stolen by, what is it, Takashi 69?
Wait, really?
Yeah, that's what it says in IMDb, whether that's true or not. But so like it was kind of, he knew the situation pretty well.
So you're wrong. He's not just an actor. He's a method actor.
Oh, yeah.
No kidding.
Like we said, Damani is there. He kind of sees all this go down and... He's just not having a lot of confidence in Howard. They already have kind of a strained relationship. Mm-hmm. Howard's supposed to be selling, like, his, I guess they're fake Rolexes or stolen them or something. And Howard is kind of, like, storing them for him. We also meet Julia. That's his mistress. She's working, like, reception and sales and stuff.
There is an important point in here. That whole thing with him not selling his Rolexes, is that part of his long con to get Kevin Garnett like attached to the Opal and just singular focus on that? Or is this kind of...
I thought that comes back at the end when he goes to get him and there's only three and there was a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
I thought he's been giving them away or stealing them.
Yeah, he's been pawning them off and placing bets, I think, with the money.
There's
he's
a lot
been...
of parlays out there with those watches.
Yeah.
Like when he goes to the guy in the restaurant, he like tries to give him a free Rolex. That was probably one of the key standards.
One of Damani's.
That guy, Mike Francesa.
Yeah. What do I know him from? He's a sports.
He's a big sports talk radio guy.
Okay. He screams a lot.
He's not like Mad Dog or anything, but I mean,
okay.
He's like a, you know, Northeastern sports talk guy.
Turn around. Don't even step in my place. Turn around.
I got some
bets. Don't even sit down.
24 Gs.
24 Gs. Where would you get 24 Gs?
I want the OKC Lakers. I want the fucking over. All right. Yeah. I want Kobe's under.
Kobe under.
Fucking all of a sudden he's passing.
Throw in the ocean. Yeah.
He's not scoring tonight. I want the Sixers to cover.
Plus one.
The points.
Let's finish the bet here. Hey, one thing at a time. I mean, come on now.
His points. Yo, Damani.
We finished the bet.
If he gets to the store before I do, you just fucking keep me. Okay, you promise me? Kevin Garnett is coming to my fucking showroom right now.
So, yeah, KG shows up, and his bodyguards are, like, beating up a bunch of people, causing a ruckus outside of Danny's store. And he's been brought in by Damani, who brings him in to look around. I guess there's, like, a misunderstanding outside. While KG is in the store, this is when Howard finally gets the stone in his hands. And, Brett, how does he get this thing mailed to him? Like... What do you think is going through Howard's mind as he's unwrapping this thing?
Well, like at first he can't find it. I'm sure he's probably thinking there is the stone. That was bad. That was more like
that is a
Scandinavian.
Oh, brother, this guy stinks.
Well, it's not it stinks that Mikey did the best impression of that earlier, but he's got it wrapped in fish. I mean, a bunch of dead fish.
Your sea bass, right?
I don't know.
Just to hide it in shipping and just so nobody's aware of it. I don't know. I feel like the guy who like hand delivered it to him, I feel like he knew something because he did something at the door. Like, I don't know why they would cut back to him, but it's like maybe he was in on knowing that there was a giant rock in this package or something.
Josh, I don't want to like, I don't want to give out too many much information, but your relative who worked down at the border-ish, you think that would have fooled him?
I feel like that's a lot of information.
All right, oh my hit a point. Gosh. I swear you've talked about him on the pod before, so that's why I felt mildly comfortable, but I guess we can just scrap this whole part.
I will just say that it is a very good hiding place, and when Howie has several employees quit on him, this is like this is also preluding the Great Resignation, this movie. It's very prophetic, but mm-hmm. as his first, like, one of his right-hand men is, like, leaving him and just talking to him, he says, like, one of the most hilarious things in the background. I'm sitting here spilling my guts out, and you're looking through fucking fish. And it's like a million-dollar gem. He's, like, getting out of the fish, but this scene is so ridiculous. And Mikey, it's also where you got the opening spoiler quote, right? Like, yeah, he's all
holy
about
shit, I'm gonna come.
Oh, jeez. Is this why he didn't get the Oscar, this line? Like, no nods because of this.
This should have gotten him the Oscar. It should have been the lock.
Yeah, he wanted it so badly.
And yeah, we can talk about that maybe at the end or right now if you guys want. But this thing got zero nominations for that 2019 Oscar year or whatever. It might have been late. I think it like came out the same month the Oscars came out or something. So, but yeah, we all love this movie when we watched it and were kind of shocked when it got zero nominations. So I don't know if you guys wanted to say anything like you thought it should have been nominated for or...
How do you not give it Best Original Screenplay?
Thank you.
A nomination? Like, I feel like that at a minimum, and maybe I don't even know where they are with the sound categories, if it's one or if it's two. But the mixing, the sound mixing, mm-hmm. there's so many moments in the jewelry shop with like the buzzer going off and shit, and the score coming in, and people just screaming over each other. Yeah. Like, it's so well like mixed. At least those two. I mean, I feel like the Academy holds grudges.
This is the year Bohemian Rhapsody won editing.
Yep.
This is such a well edited in the writing and in the what you see on screen. Like, it's unbelievable. This is a different league than Bohemian Rhapsody. That was a turning point for me in the Oscars. You were talking about it pre-pod, Pat, but
the thing about the Oscars are, though, they're incredibly petty, and I feel like they just didn't want to nominate Adam Sandler for a Best Actor nomination.
Did he get nominated for Punch Drunk Love? Or is that a Golden Globe nomination?
I don't think he's ever been nominated for an Oscar.
Those bastards.
Yeah, I mean, he was just so good in Happy Gilmore.
But I feel like it's like once you make Jack and Jill, they're not going to let you get an Oscar nomination.
Oh,
no matter how good you are.
Yeah, I obviously think it should have been nominated for at least a couple things. Certainly production wise, I obviously love the soundtrack, and Pappy, right, the audio is pretty crazy throughout the whole movie.
Golden Globes, you're right, Stevie.
Gotcha.
He did win an Independent Spirit Award Best Male Lead for Uncut Gems.
The coveted Independent Spirit.
He's won a lot of Golden Razzies.
Why isn't it celebrated, someone that goes to the both polar ends of the opposite spectrum?
Like, shouldn't it be like celebrated? I mean, yeah.
It's so
absolutely
cool.
Should be. Yeah. He's so cool.
He's so cool, man.
The only other man to do it, Pacino. With Adam Sandler.
To be honest, though, like, it is pretty freaking badass by the Safdie brothers, right? That's how you say it? Safdie?
Safdie, yeah.
First, they get Robert Pattinson in Good Time, which, even to more of an extent then, he was known as the Twilight guy, right? Or maybe the Harry Potter guy. He's still somewhat known as the Twilight guy, even though he's played Batman, like Corey always talks about. But then they get the stupid fucking comedy guy, you know what I mean? Like, who makes some of the worst, literally some of the worst major budget movies that have ever been made, Adam Sandler, and they put him in this. That's so cool, actually. You know, like, and they're both incredible fucking movies.
Yeah, it's kind of like weird seeing him just turn it on when he wants to be a serious actor. But he's been doing it for like 30 years, so he's obviously got like the 10,000 hours. He's, I don't know. When you think about it, he's been around forever. He should be a fairly good actor.
This is classic good directing, though, too, with a good actor. And I was listening to a little bit of an interview with the Safdie brothers, and they said one of the big things is a big theme they had when directing him was telling him he always had, quote, three screens on in his life. And they would kind of label him like, here's your A, B, and C screen. So it might be like the game on TV is A, his girlfriend is B, and his like son learning about his girlfriend is C. You know, like whatever the examples are. And sometimes like between cuts, they would just like toss out a letter to be like, this is like prominently what you're worried about for just like a few seconds to lead this. I just thought that was a really interesting way to like, it also leads to like the paranoia of just thinking of three screens like on and all that like chatter and anxiety. It's just pretty cool. It's so cool.
Yeah, anxiety. That's a good point. I feel that every time I watch this movie. It does a good job of making you feel that while you're watching it. So when we get to this rock shows up at the store. Howard is just like so fucking excited to show KG. He's just wants to share it with everybody because he's spent months trying to get this thing imported. And so he shows it to KG. KG immediately becomes obsessed. He's just taken over by the stone. Josh, has anything ever just taken over every, like, your whole attention, and you've just become so enraptured with something that you can't focus on anything else?
I do think that when the Nintendo 64 was brand new, and I don't know what grade I was in. Brett, do you think we were in, like, fourth grade?
64? Yeah.
Third grade, fourth grade, fifth 96, grade.
96, I think.
Something like that. But I remember
a little later, yeah.
There was an early Star Wars game, and I went over to somebody's house, and they were just flying ships through space on N64. And I was...
The sacred Jedi tech!
And I... Mikey, this is, to me, my favorite part of the movie. When Kevin Garnett... We've seen his like whole athletic career play in front of our eyes. Like,
there's like a school picture that flashes for like 1 second.
He looks into this opal, the synthesizers hit in one of those magic moments that we were talking about earlier.
Why has it got so many colors in it, man? What is this?
That's the thing. They say you can see the whole universe in opals. That's how fucking old they are.
Holy shit.
I've been telling you. That's why I wanted you to see it.
Yo, that's crazy, man.
It's fucking from stone to stone. Garnet's a stone, you know that. That's a $1 million opal you're holding, straight from the Ethiopian Jewish tribe. I mean, this is old school, Middle Earth shit.
Got a motherfucking dinosaur, Jimmy.
Yes, man. The dinosaurs, that's right. The dinosaurs fucking stared at this thing. It's 110 million years old, at the least. This thing shit was basketball. Can't lean on the glass here.
And he has this, like, euphoric...
Anything is possible!
My entire life has led to this.
Time and space, like, kind of become him, and it's really trippy and cool. And does anyone else just, like, really love this shit?
I mean, it's okay, but Bohemian Rhapsody had a hard cut to Midwest USA. Yeah.
Don't forget. Let me stop you guys right there. You guys are getting your ears mixed up.
Okay.
This unfortunately came out probably the best year in movie history. So
2019 it came out, because in the 2020
it was for the 2019 awards ceremony. So it, I'm not saying it did or didn't deserve it, but that's
did they nominate 9 or 10?
I thought the thing
year.
Was it came 10. Out like the same month the Oscars came out, or like
I
a month
it came out
before.
In December.
Yeah, it came out December, but like they didn't release it on Netflix until like January, February, March, because I remember I got a copy to show to you guys, and it wasn't coming out on Netflix for a while, but yeah, I mean, so, I mean, I'm not saying whether or not, but yeah, let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Just 9.
So they could have nominated 10. So it's like an intent. That pisses me off more than anything. You know what I mean? It's like you have 10 spots, and this wasn't even worthy of an Oscar nomination. Like no other movie that year was. That's why they fucking suck.
Guys, why is this moment in the movie so good, though? They just show like still frames. I don't know. I'm so drawn to it, and I'm sorry to stick on to it, but what is it in here? Please tell me.
I don't know. It's just like in the beginning when we saw it going through like the space mm-hmm. or whatever type environment in the rock. I don't know. It's just like seeing KG. They do a real close up of his face, and he's just like, he's got his tongue sticking out. He's drooling on the floor looking at this rock. It's just really funny. And in my head, it's like, are all of the A24 movies connected in some way?
The A24 CU?
Are they connected in some way? Or no? Because this is just like, this rock, I wouldn't be surprised to be in like a lore of A24 movies.
Mikey, that should have been the opening question. Like, what spoiler men do you see when you look into the opal?
All of the spoiler men who's fallen before us.
I see Jake Gyllenhaal's.
Viggo Mortensen's penis.
Whoa, spooky spoilers.
And so he's like just obsessed with it, and he thinks it's like gonna make him play out of his mind. So he thinks it like grants him power in some sort of way. So he wants this thing more than anything else right now. And so he's like asking Howard if he can borrow it. And Stevie, what does Howard do? And what does he get in return for this rock?
So I love that scene with just, don't lean on the glass, KG. Don't lean on the glass.
Told you not to lean. You heard me. I said tell him not to lean. Are you
all
right?
With all the chatter in the background, it makes this entire sequence just so anxiety ridden. But I do love the interchange between like KG holding it, being like, I want this. How much you need for it? And Adam Sandler immediately going, well, that's not for sale. And KG being like, why would you show me this if you're not going to sell it to me? I think, I mean, it's just great how Howard's brain honestly works. But he needs it. He needs it. And so he decides to trade off his championship ring to Howie, which Howie, and then in return, takes that to get pawned off, which takes that in return to go place a parlay. It's just great.
Yeah, it's just, it's like, it amps up the anxiety in like 10 seconds, because as soon as he gets that ring, he's in the pawn shop down the street.
Yeah.
And he's giving away another man's championship ring.
Same with like the Michael Jackson necklace. Like the way the script falls on itself is perfect.
Does he do this every week, though? This doesn't seem sustainable. Like he would have got shot a long time ago, right?
Everyone in the pawn shop knows him.
Everyone knows Howie.
Howie!
He's like Norm from Cheers.
He's like, hey, you're looking better this week type thing. Like he knows everybody.
Yeah.
And for those of you who don't know, when he's pawning this item, he's basically taking a loan out on it.
Yeah,
against the place.
With a VIG, so
he's
on taking top.
A loan out against a thing that he doesn't own, which he already owes money all over town. He could have solved this problem just by selling the opal 5 minutes ago.
Yeah, like Stevie said, he goes and pawns that ring and he places that bet with Mike Francesa. He's just got a lot of confidence in Kevin Garnett because he's talking a big game in the store. And he, like we said, saw his life flash before his eyes. He thinks he has superpowers.
Amazing.
He thinks he's going to play like LeBron right now. What team was LeBron on at this point? 2012? The Heat?
Got to be Cavs.
Oh, they're
Heat,
Cavs.
I thought.
Oh, is it?
I think he's with the Heat.
He's on the Heat.
Yeah.
He went there in 10, 11, 12, 13, I think.
And who wins the championship?
In 12? Heat.
Yeah, he did.
If it's his third season, it's the Heat. Because they went loss, win, win, loss.
So Kevin loses the stone in checking. And it gets lost on a plane. That's why they don't win that year.
That fair use thing is blowing my mind. Like,
is it awesome?
Is it always because they like it's on a TV screen that is shot with another camera, and it's never longer than X amount of seconds.
And
that's pretty crazy.
To think Universal took down one of our fucking episodes for playing 5 minutes of or 5 seconds of music. Like,
ridiculous.
Insane.
We don't even want to say the artist's name, but it is like we always talk about and like legitimately break down the soundtrack and critique it. So it really should be fair use, don't you think, Pat? Like, I don't think it's bullcrap.
Well, I think even this should be fair use. I think like the like if anything, copyright laws are like too restrictive, and like people on YouTube, you know, are always bitching about like how it's just like an algorithm coming in and like taking away their income and stuff.
Do you think Post Malone lost any album sales because we had him in 3.5 seconds between the spoiler and like the opening? Like, it's so stupid.
I get a little fuzzy on when it comes to like sports and stuff, but like one of the main things about fair use is just like you said, if it's like a market substitution. So I don't think anybody could like watch Uncut Gems and be like, oh, I'm watching 76ers Celtics. You know what I mean? You're not gonna get the same thing out of it. It's a totally, you're totally transforming it.
Do you think Safdie brothers are big enough that they're kind of like, come at me, bro, this would be great marketing for the movie if you sued us?
I don't know if they are. Adam Sandler might be.
Josh, this is where Francesa rejects that watch Howard gives him. He's like, "This, I don't want this fucking stolen shit or whatever." So he doesn't take it, and Francesa thinks he's an idiot for this bet, and he's really doubting his confidence. And Howard turns around and says something. I don't know. It's like, "I don't think so, my friend."
I disagree.
I disagree, Gary.
So yeah, he thinks he's gotten in on this bet. So he's taken out crazy parlays and stuff. It's going to pay out really big.
It shows you how much that Kevin Garnett moment actually means to the movie. Because when he says, "I disagree," part of you is like, "I agree." Kevin Garnett has superpowers when he has this freaking opal. So, like, I love that, Mikey. Sorry, go ahead.
After that, Howard just like really wants to watch the game. Nothing else is on his mind because he has to like make sure that all of his parlays hit and all that shit. And the only thing getting in his way is his goddamn family. Stevie. he's trying to watch this game at home. What does his wife want him to do?
Bring the kids out so they can get divorced in front of them.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
I mean, these two obviously are just, this marriage is dead at this point. And, you know, Howard is so fixated on this game, which rightfully so, like, I wouldn't say rightfully so, but in the context of, you know, throwing down, how much does he put down in the original Kevin Garnett bet?
Like 20.
21? Yeah. He puts down 21 in the original Kevin Garnett bet. Like, he is just, you know, so fixated on, I got to hit this, I got to hit this. And I love how he's sitting in his kid's bed, like as his kid's like trying to sleep, he's at the end of it. And he's like just watching the game with headphones on, trying to make himself feel better, being like, you know, I'm spending time with the kids, but, you know, I'm watching KG instead. Like, it's just ridiculous.
Yeah, and he eventually wins big, or like all of his parlays hit and all that shit. And he's about to like take an Uber or something to his apartment to bang Julia, and he's in a good mood. He hides in the closet and like freaks her out or something, pops out of the closet. So he's in a good mood, and he thinks that he's out of the red now at this point. I don't know what he's thinking, but as far as we're concerned, as of this point, his debts are paid off. If he just goes and pays his bookies or whatever. After that, all of the weird-looking guys that he owes money to. They just kind of show up and and are like looking for their money like the very next day. And Pap, you mentioned these two weird looking twins. What? How does he like shake them? How does he get rid of them in front of Damani?
He gives them a wash, which may or may not be Damani's 100% to begin is. With. And he's like, here, take this Rolex. It's worth like $20,000 or something, which is a fake Rolex anyway. And then as he walks up to Damani, he pretends like the two twins were trying to sell him the Rolex. He's like, back off. No, I don't need a watch today. I'm good. And Damani like ushers him away. But like, he does kind of get fucked over a little bit by Damani and KG in the scene, right? Even though we know Howard pawned the ring, like, this sucks for him.
Like, even from the beginning, KG is just like super pushy, and it's like, dude, I'm not gonna give you this rock that I'm telling you is worth like, I'm telling you with confidence because I like you, but it's like, this thing is worth $1 million. I'm not just gonna let you take it. First, I just got it. I just yanked it out of a fish. I'm not gonna give it to you. So yeah, he's just getting kind of like played for far too long in this movie. I feel uncomfortable for him, and he does get played for such a large portion of this movie. The thing he worked so hard to get wasn't even in his own possession for most of the movie. Yeah, but Damani drives him to Philly because he tells him they're going to go get the stone, and then he ends up ditching him at the stadium. And so Howard's pissed. He's got to drive back to the city. He's got to go
take
see
a bus.
His kids play. Yeah, he looks like an idiot. Josh, he's got to go to his kids play. Who does he run into?
Oh, no, it's Phil again.
Philadelphia.
And we kind of skipped over, I said the time where Phil slaps him and then he touches his cheek right where he gets shot later in the bullet wound. But the second time we see Phil, it's when he's like, he got beat up by KG's guards and he's like threatening to kill Howie so specifically. It's like so scary. We see him on the street and then here he is, one of his most terrifying moments when Adam Sandler is just like talking to the neighbors about this upcoming play and upcoming vacations, and he looks to the back of the theater and like through people's heads he sees in this crease freaking Phil just like scoping him out at his kid's play. That's really this is a great scene. I think overall this is a great setup.
These guys are all throughout the movie just kind of like sitting on a chair through a window, like staring at Howie, just kind of like, I don't know, like the camera will zoom in on them, just kind of like scoping Howie out, just kind of following him and tailing him and shit. They're getting way too close. Howie feels threatened for his family and stuff. And yeah, he lures them outside and then he gets the shit beat out of him and locked in his car.
He has no plan when he's doing this. Like, what the fuck is he thinking? He asks them to step outside and then, like, his first move is just to bite the dude's arm. He has no plan. Like, how is this going to work out well, Howard? What were you thinking?
I think he was planning on ditching his family. Just driving away. I don't know. He's desperate. He's very desperate, and he has no money to pay these guys, so, like, what else is he going to do? But I guess Arno was nice enough to just, like, beat the shit out of him, strip him of his clothes, and lock him in the trunk and kind of just, like, humiliate him.
Are you serious, though? Like, this is probably my biggest note, Mikey, and I've been holding off railing on him. Arno is, like, he's a bigger POS than Howie. Watching this again for the second time really points that out. Like, the reason Howie's being scouted out at his kid's play is because, like, his brother-in-law knows he's going to be there. And he is, like, he's out of his league messing with this, like, Phil guy. He can't control him. He thinks he's tough. Like, I hate Arno so much in this movie. He is, like, the biggest piece of shit to me.
You don't feel bad for Arno at Passover when the dad just skips over him during the reading?
No, and the dad is such a nice guy. And if you trust anyone's, judgment of character in this movie, it's him.
It's Gooey.
And he's like, Howie, even you, who I know is a piece of shit, I'm going to tell you, this Arno guy, he feels like a wolf in here. Like, we hate him.
He said happy holidays.
You know what he says to me? He comes over to me and says, happy holidays. It's like it's Christmas. It's like having an intruder in your own home.
He's not bothering anybody, all right? He's trying.
Yeah, easy for you to say. I didn't marry your daughter.
I mean, he looks like a bad guy, and he is a bad guy. Yeah, but yeah, we find out, like, in the next scene that Arno is, yeah, his brother-in-law.
How did this not get best original screenplay? It's so good.
The way they reveal that he's his brother-in-law at that dinner party.
It's a perfect reveal. It's perfect. Like, everything building up to it.
A lot of good nominees that year.
Everything building up to it makes sense. And, I mean, just the idea that, like, you know, the trick on the brain of, like, what the hell is, like, our main antagonist doing here? And it's like, oh, my God, it's his brother-in-law, too. Like, it's just, it's perfect.
It makes sense, too, when he uses the dad to, like, bid up the opal later.
Yes.
Do you think he did something similar to Arno?
Well, he knows, I mean, Arno's obviously, like, a loan shark. And he's out $100,000 with Howie. And, you know, it's perfect stuff of, like, even before he knows his brother-in-law, he's like, I hear your kids are going to Timberlake. Like, you're resurfacing the pool, and you're like, you know, who's talking to Arno about all this? Oh, my God. And it's like, oh, it's because it's his brother-in-law, and he's hearing all this info from his wife.
It's just in the family thread.
It's just in the family thread. It's perfect.
Okay, Brett, to your point, Parasite, Knives Out, Marriage Story, 1917,
I'm looking
Once
at
Upon
it,
yeah. a Time in Hollywood. Would you take out any of those four Uncut Gems? I don't know. Maybe Knives Out for me. But that is
Marriage Story.
I wouldn't take any of those out. I mean, you're asking the wrong person.
Brett, what's your deal, man?
Yeah.
I feel like you're pretty down on this movie.
Yeah, you seem jumpy, man.
Let's just proceed.
No, what's your...
No,
give us
a
podcast.
Check.
Podcast, talk.
We'll get there.
Just say it now.
Is it yes or no's?
I don't... We all know it's probably a no, I guess, but like...
We won't attack you for your opinion, I promise.
I just want a vibe check. Yeah, like, why...
Is it too anxiety-inducing?
I freaking hated this movie.
No! I love it. No, I love this. A lot of people do.
My favorite part is when the credits came up.
Dude.
It's too much anxiety for Brett.
Say your piece.
One thing is Brett hates stupid characters.
Yeah.
And how he makes so many stupid decisions.
Yeah.
Oh, he's an idiot.
Here's the thing. It's not that I don't see... I mean, obviously, the colors in this movie were awesome. The directing was awesome. The acting was so-so. It's original. But to me, if you're going to make the most obnoxious and uncomfortable movie I've ever seen... You at least owe me a freaking happy ending.
Oh, no.
And I didn't get that. I know you like that, Stevie, but I don't.
I respect it because I feel like there are a huge percentage of people who agree with you.
And now I don't want to watch Good Time.
You've never seen Good Time?
Nope.
It's almost like a happy ending for Howie,
yeah.
I would argue.
No, it is a happy ending. It is.
Sweet release.
Until you think about how they probably kill his girlfriend and they probably kill his family, too.
Oh, that's all off screen.
Yeah.
That doesn't matter.
No. Josh has a good point, though. It does have a happy ending for Howie, like 100%.
Because he would have lost that million
the next
week.
If you dive into like the gambler's mind, this is the happiest moment of Howie's life. Is this parlay that hit with this much on the line? And the way that gambling addicts, their brains work, is say Howie, you know, hit a $50,000 parlay. It's his brain works like it's not that he hit a $50,000 parlay. He lost $100,000 because he didn't bet more. That's how his brain works. And this is probably the happiest moment of Howie's life. So dying right there is it rhymes. It's poetry.
Yeah, it's happy for him. It's not happy for me. We knew a guy in college who was a really good poker player. And one night he won $30,000 playing online poker. But because of who he is. Before he logged out, he went and lost $8,000 in 5 minutes on blackjack.
Yep.
Because that's how he is. And I get that.
Hey, positive 22K.
1-800-GAMBLER if you're struggling.
Brett, I honestly don't agree, though, that the girlfriend and family are getting killed. I think these guys committed some murders. They're getting gems, and they're getting the hell out of there.
They got arrested.
Yeah, they're arrested because everything in that pawn shop is on video.
Well, no. They can't get out. They're arrested.
Maybe they committed suicide jumping out the window to JoJo's or something.
Well, one of them can get out because they can buzz each other out.
Oh, that's true.
The prisoner's dilemma.
Wait, so what? Seb, I never really thought this out. What is the dilemma here? What are you guys saying? They can't. They're both in there, so only one of them can ever get out. So one of them has to be arrested.
Well, they're definitely on tape.
Yeah,
I'm a little confused as to how the second door opens. Like once,
yeah,
Howie,
I don't know how they can get out either.
Once Howie sticks that thing in, could they have just gone out the front door too?
No, they can get out because they show earlier that if you have Howie's key, you can get through the door.
Because
he lets himself in, and then he lets himself in once he gets inside the middle part.
I thought these guys were looking for a cash out, not to go, like, cartel everyone's family or anything, like that freaking Brad Pitt movie, The Counselor or something.
I like the point that you made, Josh, that Arno has control of this guy, because Arno is related to Howard, yet he couldn't stop Phil from killing Howard and himself. So it's like, I don't know. And then Arno also looked like super scared at the end. Mm-hmm. Like
that's great acting.
Yeah, that actor is awesome.
Well, I like him. He's good at everything. He's in your show, isn't he, Stevie? Succession?
Hold on, Brett. You hated him.
What's his name?
He's in Succession. Oh, is he?
I don't know how to say his
name. Is he in Succession?
I know from, yeah, I know from Under Siege 2 and Wonderland, but.
Eric Bogosian? Bogosian?
Yeah. Bogosian, that sounds right. Bogosian, that's
who he plays in Succession.
Bogosian.
Eric Bogosian? Bogosian? Yeah,
he's great, though.
The only person who acted better than him was probably The Weeknd.
Yeah, we'll just fly through this part real quick.
Gil Evis? I don't know.
The senator.
Oh, the senator. Gotcha.
Shiv works for.
Yeah.
Howard and Damani meet up at a Weeknd concert. He wants to get the stone back. Damani doesn't have it. Howard's girlfriend, Julia, is like in the back about to bang The Weeknd and do coke in the bathroom. He goes back there and like causes a ruckus and then ends up getting beat up and he leaves in a cab yelling at Julia. They pretty much break up and he like asks her to clean all of her stuff out of the apartment.
I had a note about this, Mikey. Howard's so narcissistic that he tunes everybody else out like in different ways, right? Whether it's like saying I'm gonna come while his employee's like quitting and spilling his guts to him, or if he's just like making this ridiculous scene in front of all these people. Like, they're just screaming at each other on the street in front of dozens and dozens of people.
Get Blue, a huge fucking sale for me!
Why were you selling your fucking hot snacks? Throw my whole fucking life away for this skank over here!
Oh, wow! Yeah. Okay, now I'm a fucking skank!
Where the fuck are
Listen,
you?
Listen, Howard, you knew what the fuck it was when you met me.
That's
okay?
Right. Yeah, that's why I wish I never fucking met you. Right here.
Oh, wow. That's great, Howard. Howard!
Get out of my fucking way.
Howard!
Go fuck The Weeknd, all right?
We didn't fucking do anything!
Fuck off of me. Go. Bye. Go. Good night. Bye. Get the fuck away.
I can understand why he's mad. He's like so invested in this rock. This is going to be like the thing to get him out of his hole of debt or whatever. But it's like, dude, you're meeting up at a nightclub. This guy isn't just going to hand over this rock in the middle of a nightclub or something. I don't know. He's asking a lot. And he's like not reading the room, I guess, for the situation he's in.
He's got a cool shirt, though. Very cool shirt.
Yeah, he's definitely out of place. He's certainly like older than everybody by like 15 years. And this is where we meet the guy who has the Michael Jackson piece, which he's also like currently in the process of pawning. So he's just like pawning other people's shit off to pay his own debts. We just see more scumbaggery from him.
It's constantly robbing Peter to pay Paul. To also lay a parlay.
Yeah.
Next scene, KG ends up coming back. He's brought the Rock back. Howard is like, I think he called like, God, who's the guy who owns the Celtics? Auerbach or something? I don't know. He calls someone and he's like, KG, I have to file a complaint against.
Pretty sure he doesn't call Red Auerbach on the phone.
This is Howard Ratner.
Yeah, my assistant told me that you called. How are you doing?
I'm not going to lie to you. I could be better.
Sorry to hear that. So what can I do for you?
I've been having a situation with one of your higher profile players, and I'm moments away right now from making things very ugly for you.
Okay. Can you hang on for
No,
a second,
I'm not
please?
Hanging on. I happen to be a litigious individual.
Mm. Yeah, KG brings it back. Everybody is pissed in the room. KG just wants to give him 175 outright for it. And Howard is just like, no, I can't because it's still going up for auction tomorrow. And he tells him to, like, just go to the auction and bid on it yourself.
This is like the opposite of what happened to Adam Sandler and Happy Gilmore with the house. Like, just go bid on the house, Happy. And then Shooter McGavin comes and bids him out of it.
Speaking of it, I wish this movie would be better if Lafferty Daniels was the lead character and not Happy Gilmore. Thank you, Stevie. I knew you, at least you would get it.
Lafferty Daniel, Gilmore, Happy.
More family time after that, after KG shows up. This is where we see the relationship with Arno. Brett, how awkward are these family gatherings? You know a man who also has a horrible time with family. His name is Aaron Rodgers.
Gosh,
are these better or worse family gatherings for Howard and Arno?
Well, they exist at least.
Yeah, these two guys are actually meeting up to celebrate.
Yeah, and they shouldn't be, so because not all families get along. It's awkward, and it's made more awkward by the 48 times that they make eye contact. Josh, you probably do like the part when he tells Arno that he's a pussy.
Arno, what the fuck? Can we just fucking talk? We're family. We're here right now.
Get out of my way.
Yeah, yeah, not so tough without your friends around, are you? Are you? Are you? Fucking pussy.
You like it, or you think I like it?
Well, no, I mean... you kind of mentioned that he's just kind of a scumbag, and
you hate Arno.
Yeah. Who said that I hated Arno?
No, Josh does.
I do.
Josh is a big hater of Arno.
They're awkward, Mikey, to answer your question. But I love Judd Hirsch and like anything.
Howard makes a comment about the stone or something, and Arno gives him a really
this is stone.
Just a really nasty look. When he hears about how much money Howard is going to make on this deal, and
I know you hate Arno, Josh, but like, you got to understand, he's the black sheep brother-in-law. Howard, even though he's like this like degenerate gambler, everybody in the family seems to love him, and like only he knows like what a piece of shit he really is. Like, that's relatable, right? And he still doesn't want to kill Howard in the end. That's admirable.
Yeah, I don't agree with Josh saying that he's a worse guy than Howie, but, you know, he's pretty bad. I mean, I think Phil's the worst guy.
But Arno isn't bright.
He brought Phil into the picture.
Desperation's a stinky cologne, Josh.
I mean, who gives Howie $100,000?
Yeah, $100,000 to your idiot brother-in-law? That's on you, pal.
I'm reading through it, and chances are that bad guy Phil and the other goon never made it out of the shop. That's like everybody's consensus is they never made it out.
Why do you say?
Just the simple fact that, like, you know, the whole key file, electronic key thing that Brett was talking about? Like, I don't think Howard had it on him in that moment. He only had one. I think him and Julia shared it. And also, like, the two-door system... Like, to open that door, you have to buzz from the outside. Like, I mean, they never would have made it out.
So when Julia lets go to the bathroom, quote unquote, and she took the key.
She took the key with her. So they would never would have made it out. And since the fact that you hear sirens going, like not too far after like the murders, like they're not getting away.
Mm. I love how that plays into Adam Sandler's like hubris too, because he probably like knew that.
He knew that, like, but those two idiots did.
Yeah, exactly. He's like, ha ha ha, without me, they cannot make it out of here.
Right.
But they're just like, fuck this guy, he put us in a cage. He's going to die now.
And now they're going to get arrested in that same cage.
Phil was in prison before, right?
Yeah, yeah,
100%. He doesn't want to be in a cage. Like, get it? Get it?
Yeah, just on the way back home, Howie stops by the apartment to make sure Julia is out of there. And that's where his son kind of figures out that he has a girlfriend living in the apartment when he goes to take a shit in that one guy's. God,
kid just couldn't hold it.
Yeah. Just another awkward family car ride home for this family. The next day is the auction. Pap, the auction doesn't go to plan for Howard. What does he ask? It's his dad?
Father-in-law.
What does he ask his... Oh, his father.
Gooey.
What does he ask his father how to do for him?
Gooey. God, you just feel so bad for him. Real quick, back to that scene in the bathroom, or the hallway, though. I love how the dad from Good Time just shows
John
up.
John Amos.
That's so random, but so hilarious. He's a legend. Back off. But yeah, so he gets to the auction. He realizes at this moment, because he's waited so long to get it appraised, that they're like devaluing it, and there's not even a picture of it in the thing, and there's like this whole notice that it's worth less. So his plan is to ask his father-in-law. This is probably the first time he's like crossed the line of like asking him for money, I think, based on their relationship. But he's going to ask him to bid it up. And man, dude, this auction scene is so stressful. Every time you watch this movie, like I'm just like, stop, just don't bid one more time. But it's always Howard like egging him on, and he just feels so bad.
Yeah, and they're in there bidding against KG. KG eventually finds out that they were bidding against him to pump up the bids and stuff, and he's pissed about that when he eventually comes back to buy it later. But before that, he runs into Arno again one more time as he's putting his father-in-law into the car. This is apparently a very wealthy family. Regardless, they're driving away in a Bentley or something. It's just like the father-in-law, he knows he shouldn't have helped Howard, and he fucks up on his own, but like everybody is just so trusting of Howard and keeps giving him chances and chances that he just keeps like digging a bigger hole for himself. And he's just fucking up more and more. So now he owes his father-in-law like all of the money for the auction, and he's still got to sell the stone to get that money. And Arno is like down at the lobby floor to like have Phil punch him in the throat and toss him in the fountain right after his father-in-law takes off.
Which is like the least scary thing he does in the movie.
And then we get like the really funny scene afterwards of him walking back to his store. He cries in front of Julia. Josh, what is he saying to Julia at this moment in time? He's just kind of like wallowing in everything that's happened to him.
Have you guys ever heard John Lennon's "I'm a Loser"?
Mm-hmm.
He's just kind of like, everything I do turns to shit. I don't
know. Lennon McCartney wrote that. Yep.
It's kind of like I noticed when she saw his like wounds from getting beat up and is almost like being motherly to him, he reverts to like this very childish.
That's good.
I don't know. Stevie, are you picking up any
weird
of that
relationship?
She's half his age, but playing a mother character is kind of disturbing.
Like, someone has to with Howie, I guess, because, you know, we really, really never see his parents, and his wife hates him, and we never really see him being a father. And, I mean, it's I guess it's a way to kind of get sympathy for the character of Howie, which is just, you know, seeing him at his rock bottom, only to, you know, rise from the ashes not too far after this. But what is that tattoo that she gets? I completely forget.
Howie.
Is it just Howie? Say Howie?
Just Howie. Yeah.
I love how he just loves it.
Holy shit, I'm gonna
come. Dude.
Oh, KG comes by to buy the stone. He's still so entranced by it, and he pays $165K because I think Damani took his cut, which was like $10K. So now at this point, Howard should be good. He should have his debts paid off after the sale of this stone at this point to KG. No, he immediately turns around and places a bet on KG. He gives him some crazy speech.
I love about, that speech. It's so good.
KG somehow asked him about the Ethiopian miners that had gotten this stone from him and how he's kind of taking advantage of those guys. And
weak moment. That was lame.
Why? What was your problem with
it? When he's like questioning the morality because he paid $100,000 for something he was going to sell for $1 million. Why? I don't. That just doesn't resonate.
I think KG's point was that that Howard thought it was $1 million and he only gave these people in Africa $100,000. Like they're clearly not rich people.
Yeah, he undersold them. Yeah,
he's taking advantage of them. I think was.
I
like
get
the,
his point, but KG, in the context of this movie, is visiting this dingy, like, jeweler that he knows is like doing illegal stuff, and he's like pontificating
on the day
about
of game seven.
Like, what's he doing?
This movie is wild because KG does not look like a good guy at all in this movie. It's just weird. Yeah, he places that bet. He has Julia on the helicopter to like Atlantic City or something. And Arno and his goon show up. They're pissed. They see Julia turn around and pretend like she's going to the bathroom. They know something's up. And they end up following her. They find like the email receipt for the helicopter. And they follow her all the way there to the casino. Stevie, what happens at the casino? How does this bet go?
I mean, to bring up kind of like the casino area, that like whale that she's with, or that's constantly trying to get through, the guy with the awful hair and the spray tan. Like,
I love that guy. He's hilarious.
Is he an actor or is that just a guy?
That's gotta be a real
fashion
guy.
He's a fashion designer. His name's Wayne Diamond.
Okay. That is great.
Does he know he's playing that role?
Like, I mean, I don't even know if it's like beyond parody at this point, but like guys like that, like, I mean, whales like that, especially they go like Vegas or Atlantic City, like they very much so do exist. And a lot of them.
What are you saying?
Whales.
I think you need to explain whales to the audience what you're saying.
The Archie blows.
Pretty much the guys, like when they walk into a casino, they get like their own private rooms for poker. Like they're not going to like, I mean, these guys are going to be spending millions on blackjack. Not like,
yeah, they want to schmooze them up because they know that they're going to be losing a lot of money. Probably,
right. These guys like will show up with like an entourage. Like when these guys show up immediately, the casino is like there to like cater to them. Cause like the money that can be won for, like from these guys. So that's like what a whale is. And that's why I pictured this guy, you know, like with the chopper and the penthouse and anything you need. And just, I just kind of like how we got to look into that world.
Just expecting so much from Julia, come up to my room, have a drink.
Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah.
He's a lonely guy. He doesn't have anybody in the world to spend his money with. All right, Brett, I'm really glad that you shared your opinion. And I think I'll give you that he's not a good actor, but I think he does fit the role. You know what I mean? It's almost a little bit over the top and silly.
Oh yeah, I don't really mind him. And actually, apparently it's like a fictionalized version of himself, so I'm sure he had fun with it. It doesn't bother me. That didn't bother me that much. None of it bothered me. I just said I could tell that they weren't actors. That guy looks like Wayne Newton's younger brother.
I don't know. For some reason, I just like, I need to see a guy with fucked up teeth trying to get money out of Howard rather than like a guy looking like Bradley Cooper trying to get money out of Howard. I don't know. It's just more like the pawn shop guys. Like, those are real guys.
The twins, I'm with Brett. That seems like too over the top, and the acting is bad, and it just seems like a bad choice. But you know the scene where, like, he's asking his son, or his son wants to go to the bathroom, and they're opening up these, like, different New York apartment doors? Like, that is where the Safdie brother, like, that feels so real. And I don't know if those are actors or if those are, like, actual, like, NYC residents. But, like, I think that's part of why, like, having some casting being non-actors kind of creates this, like, suspension of disbelief in a kind of a cool way.
The twins got a big laugh when I saw this in theaters, specifically the second time when he's, like, at the door when all this other shit's going down. Like, that is, it's just too much.
She places this insane bet, dumps all that money on the teller for Howard, for the bet. And in the same time, Howard ends up trapping, like we've been talking about throughout the podcast, Howard ends up trapping Arno and the goons inside this two-door system. And they're just kind of like roasting in there until the end of, like, throughout this entire basketball game. They got to watch this shit with Howard. They're just kind of like getting angrier and angrier in this tiny, it looks like a heated room. Stevie, Arno's just kind of like, I don't know. I feel like he's like watching and rooting for Howard at the same time.
He's 100% rooting for Howard.
Phil wants Howard dead. He's about to like fire a gun in this bulletproof case.
That's interesting. When did Phil decide that when this is opened, I will kill him? Because I think it's pretty early.
I told you it's when he's ragging on the guy from Boston.
Yeah.
Like, that's the exact moment.
His soul deadens a little bit more. His horcrux is split.
If Howie had lost that bet, if Howie had lost that bet, he would have lived.
He would have lived?
I think he would have lived. I really do.
Because he would have been fine with killing Howie, and Adam Sandler's character.
I think so. Part of me does. The reason I think Phil, I mean, even beyond like being in a cage and Howie just antagonizing him all movie, I think it was accumulation of that win extends Phil's problems. Like, Howie is a thorn in the side of not just Arnold, but Phil. Because Phil has to constantly do all this tailing, running around, this chasing. And that win starts that cycle all over again. And I think that win is the moment, like, he was like, okay, I'm killing him.
Wait, so you think Howie would have lived if he loses the bet?
Yes, I do.
Oh, I thought you meant Arno.
No. I think if Howie lost that bet,
interesting.
I think he lives.
I don't think Phil liked seeing Howie happy. Like, if anything pushed him over the edge, it may have been that.
Phil, he's just not happy.
The moment when they're locked inside that door and he's watching the basketball game, and we're from Indiana, all of us here.
It's
basketball, guys.
Mm-hmm.
That's like kind of what cinema is made for. That, like, sorry, Brett, but that tension of them sitting in there and thinking about all the emotions flowing through people, it harkens back almost to like an old Western. And I don't know. It's beautiful in a way, but it's so ugly too. It's great cinema. I love, 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 love that scene.
It does a good job of explaining the bet too, right? Because Julia runs into that guy in the casino who explains that it's like points plus rebounds plus assists or
it's like
whatever.
Good exposition.
Yeah,
it feels pretty flawless in the movie. And like, if you're not like a degenerate gambler, that's probably necessary to get that in there.
Yeah, that's a good point. That is really good exposition, because I don't know shit about gambling, but I thought it was pretty easy to follow along. And we just get like more B-roll of whatever NBA game this was or whatever, and KG is getting his stats up and he's hitting all these parlays, and Howard's losing his mind in his store. The goons are watching him. They're just getting more and more pissed off. Arno seems to be fine in this situation. And as like, I don't know why, like, not as the boss of these goons or something. He's just like, it's fine. It's cool. Just calm down or at anything. But his guys are just like, especially Phil. Phil is just ready to go as soon as he gets out of this tiny cage that he's locked in.
All right, we're up enough. We're up enough. This is not that big of a deal. This will just fucking help seal it, but we're good.
Don't talk. Just fucking do your shit, man. Do your shit. Do your shit. Do your shit. Get this shit. Come on.
All right, the truth fucking feels it. I feel it. I'm confident now. I'm confident. Don't let him shoot that. Don't let him shoot that. Don't let him shoot that. Get that. Man, that's it. Yeah. Yes. Oh, oh my God. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, my God.
And then, yeah, the game is over. Howard has hit all the parlays. He's won, like, $1.2 million or something. He gets the call from Julia. They're celebrating. Julia still is in danger. She's got to use the help of the whale to get out of here. She's he ends up taking her money out of the casino and handing it to her in a limo. She drives off. We don't see her for the rest of the movie. But Howard doesn't get to celebrate the same way. Brett, what happens to Howie in his own shop after the game?
He gets shot in the face by Phil. He finally lets them back in the shop, and then he comes out, shoots him in the face, killing him pretty much instantly.
Yeah. I mean, what were you guys expecting? Did you guys see that coming, or?
I thought he was going to hit him or pistol whip him. I didn't think he was going to shoot him.
When I was in the theaters, no, I did not see that
coming. It was pretty shocking.
The amazing camera angle it takes, like following like Howie's vision up to the ceiling is beautiful.
Oh, the mirror ceiling?
Yes.
Yeah.
Is there a little bit of Departed in this, too?
Like the fact that someone gets shot?
Remember that elevator scene when like just suddenly like Matt Damon and Leo and some other dude just get like headshot.
Oh, yeah.
It's very abrupt. It's like American Beauty as well. Spoiler alert, but like there's a tradition of movies where I don't know that someone is like playing out a day in a life that ends bang with like bullet wound to the head. And this is one of them.
I think it's good to end on a sudden violent moment, right? Because like I was thinking about this earlier. I don't even know like what section of Blockbuster you would put Uncut Gems in. Like drama?
Thriller?
Thriller?
Thriller. Thriller? Yeah, I say thriller.
But it's a thriller with like virtually like no violence, right?
Yeah.
And it's a very unique story where that thrilling sensation is coming from. Gambling addict.
Definitely shocking the first time I saw it. Just comes out of nowhere, and then we get like a slow zoom into the face wound of Howard and that gunshot wound. And it's like another trippy synth travel through space, and then credits roll.
I do like how it shows like the juxtaposition of like everybody in Howard's life and like what they're doing at the same time of like him celebrating that parlay and getting shot. I thought that was cool.
His kid is like, my dad sold jewelry.
Yeah.
Everybody else in his life seems pretty happy.
Jeez.
Howard was pretty happy for a brief moment, and then he got shot. Anything else you guys want to say before we go to yes-nos?
This movie does not feel its length.
No.
Like I can't believe this is a 2-hour and 14-minute movie. I know Brett probably disagrees.
I paused it, and I was like, there's got to be like 30 minutes left. And there was like over an hour. And I was just like, oh, my God.
It flies by for me. I can't explain it.
One thing I really like this that this movie does is not only do we have like an unlikable character as our main protagonist or anti-hero, whatever you want to call him. But like he's also such an unreliable narrator and such a liar that he almost treats the audience kind of like he treats everybody else in his life, which is just, you know, lying to us at the next score. I thought that was really cool.
But you also kind of like fall for it over and over again
mm-hmm.
in the movie, just like everyone in his life
Maybe I just I always go back to that Michael Jackson necklace. That to me is such a great payoff.
I have a Stevie question.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of. I think if there's just one scene I would cut, it would be the closet scene where he's like texting, like, you know, what are you wearing and stuff. It's not that I hate the scene, but like, what? Why is that scene in here? I
feel
like
it doesn't. It's to really build fit. Tension through the audience.
Are you supposed to think that she's cheating on him?
Yeah, so the initial seeds are like planted at the idea of like she's like running around on Howard, who has like no reason to even be mad because he's running around
so
on his wife.
So he's super suspicious. Okay.
They set it up pretty well, actually. I remember like a couple little things they could have done. Like he texts her, you know, in a different movie, she might have like looked at it and like thrown it down. Like, I don't need to respond to him. But like, I think it shows that... She's really into him. Like, she really does love him. So
Julia Fox really loves him in this movie. And I find that hard to swallow. At first glance, especially. Like, that's tough. Like, why?
Well, she is about to bang the weekend.
He's paying her rent in New York, bro.
Okay, but even Elsa laughs in his face about how ridiculous it is. But, like, I know he's paying the rent, Stevie. But I think she really loves him in this movie. But something clicked. And I think what you're supposed to maybe get is that she's the next him, right? Like, she doesn't really know about this bet and stuff and, like, how it all works. But I think there's some signs that she's, like, getting wiser and she has her own kind of, like, set of skills or something. And I did like that part of it. And maybe, I don't know, am I off base there?
I didn't get any of that, but, I mean, who knows?
I think it's more of, like, she loves him. Because she genuinely does believe that he's a winner.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I see that.
He's rubbed everybody else down, but she's relatively new. And that's why he like feeds off of her too, right? Because he needs.
And not like, all that like borrowed money is going to parlays. Like some of that's going to her.
Mm-hmm.
Like on whether it's like jewelry or new clothes, like whatever it is, like it's going to her. So, I mean, I could see why she loves Howie.
I'm pretty sure. The only time that Howard says "I love you" back to her is after he hits the big bet at the end. I think all the other time she just says "I love you" and he like ignores it because he's wrapped up in whatever else he's doing.
I'm gonna fuck the shit out of you tonight.
Yeah.
I think Happy Gilmore is actually one of the Safdie brothers' favorite movies. They did the rewatchables with Bill Simmons on Happy Gilmore. So I don't know.
Have you listened to that episode? Is it good? I kind of want to listen now.
I listened to the. Part of it. I'll probably re-listen to it again.
I'll listen to that.
I think this movie took, what, about 10 years to get off the ground?
They had, I don't know if it was that long, but they had been wanting to make it for a long time, and I guess I read that Robert Pattinson, like, saw something of theirs.
He saw and, like, a poster.
And, like, met with them and thought it was really cool, and then they kind of, like, started writing Good Time for him.
He saw a movie poster.
That popped up first.
I think they, I think at least a script, Stevie, that they had been, like, kicking it around for a really, really long time.
I think they originally passed it to Adam, like, maybe 2010, 2009? Let me see if I can find it.
I like that Natasha Lyonne and Tilda Swinton were in it. Like, I can't believe I didn't recognize Tilda Swinton's voice on the phone, because I know her pretty well, I guess.
Wait, she's in this?
She's the, like... The person who's waiting for the opal on the phone.
That's like 7 movie club for her. Sneaky Tilda.
She has a Tom Holland in Locke sort of role for this.
Yeah.
Deep cut.
How's the traffic, Brett, coming in out of Philly today?
It's fine.
Sorry, my very last note, Mikey. I like that the game ends in a very normal NBA way, right? Like, they don't have some, like, last-second three. I know that's obviously because they used game footage, but, like, what a great decision to use real game footage, right? With all of the litigation risks that we talked about. You know what I mean? They probably had to jump through a lot of hoops to get that cleared with their own team.
2009 is when they conceived the film.
Yeah, they finished their first draft of 2009, and they called it something they hadn't earned yet.
And it's funny that they approached Adam Sandler's manager, who rejected it without showing it to Adam.
In 2009?
Somewhere between 2009. I mean, sounds like right around there.
So they always wanted it to be Adam Sandler, even back then?
I think awesome. So. It looks like in 2017, Jonah Hill joined the cast. I wonder what...
That's crazy.
I wonder what he would have been. Oh, Sandler replaced Jonah Hill. What do you think? Oh, man, I bet Jonah Hill could have played a really scummy guy. Like him in Wolf of Wall Street would have been like just like that.
I can kind of picture Jonah Hill saying, I disagree, actually.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, I don't have anything else to say. Obviously, snubbed. I will say that thought it should have gotten a lot more recognition and praise when it came out. I think it, sure, down the years, we'll probably get that praise and stuff, and people like it enough now.
To my technical people, do you guys like or notice like the 35 millimeter over, I guess, what, digital? Because that's what they used.
Not when I'm watching it here on my monitor, but like I remember in the theaters just thinking how awesome it looked. It was such a cool experience in theaters, like particularly that weekend concert. Like, I don't know. That looked amazing.
What's long zoom lenses? Like, I mean, obviously I know what they are, but like what?
35 Josh. Is not long at all.
No, but I'm saying a film was shot by Darius Condi on 35 millimeter film using long zoom lenses.
I don't know, something like a 100 or 200. It just means like you'd be, the camera would be like really far, really far away.
And you're, you're pressing up on something, yeah.
Claustrophobic look?
I would say not claustrophobic, because I think claustrophobic would be like a wide angle lens and close up and sweaty. I guess there is a lot of sweat.
There's a lot of sweat.
So much, yeah.
A lot of sweat and blood.
Yeah, sometimes that confuses me. Even all this time, me like working with film and lenses and stuff is, well, I've never worked like actual film, but like 35 millimeter is like a size of tape basically, but it's also a size of lens. There's a 35 millimeter like Canon lens that I use often that's like really nice, so it's just kind of a confusing film term.
I work with cameras as well. I don't know that shit.
They used 35 millimeter film. Is that what they used?
Yeah, and they apparently wanted it so bad they took a pay cut to use it.
Yeah, it's expensive. I think it's like the standard. It was a standard for a long time. It's 35 mil.
What is the one under that? 16?
1.2 mil.
Under 35 mil?
I want to say you're right, Josh. 16. I know that. I mean, a lot of older movies and. I know Tarantino is always a fan of it, but 70 millimeter is always a big, you know, for showing great big stuff. So.
how expensive that is. That's
insane. My God, it's so expensive. So I could see why they took a pay cut, but I mean, I like the look of film personally.
Yeah, I feel like you can tell like almost fairly quickly.
The way the lights come off it, I think, is always what gives me a big tell away.
I mean, also kind of just for them, like they're telegraphing that they're really serious filmmakers. You know what I mean? Right. Mm-hmm. Like taking this kind of stuff seriously, like what's being shot on. Like, I think they really did want to get Sandman that Oscar nomination, which, I mean, I agree, Brett, looking at it, it's a pretty brutal year. It's unfortunate.
Yeah, it's bad timing for sure.
Yeah.
Do you guys see A Serious Man by the Coen brothers in this a lot? Another midlife crisis. Jewish guy with glasses that has like I don't know the Jewishness of those two movies.
Cy Abelman?
Well, they're both directed by Jewish brothers, so
brothers, right. Yeah. at risk of sounding like racist against Jewish people or something, but like those I found myself thinking of A Serious Man several times throughout this, and it's Minnesota suburbs versus New York inner city gambler
Diamond
man.
District.
Right.
35-24-16 for film width. Yeah. Those are just common ones. Obviously, there's more than that, I'm sure, but...
How many millimeters is your gun, Brett? 35?
I don't have any guns anymore. I lost them all in a tragic boating accident.
R.I.P. Glad we have that on record, officially.
Yeah. Josh, sorry. I'm going to correct myself quick. Motion picture film sizes are most common 8mm, 16, 35, and 70. Double perforations, cassette loaded. So you were right.
It's kind of insane, too. Is 70 like equivalent to like 8K or something like that?
You guys ready for trivia?
yes or no's?
Ah, shit, yeah. Go ahead.
Oh.
we'll go east to east.
Oh, me first? Oh, what am I going to give it? I'll just make this quick. The filmmaking aspects are pretty good. I like the look of it all. I just found it unbelievably obnoxious and uncomfortable, and I hated it. I looked over at my wife, who was like wincing, and I was like, man, this is crazy. She was like, I've hated every second of this movie. So that kind of, if it would have been a happy ending, maybe, but it, just because it was happy for what's Howie doesn't mean it's happy for me. It's a solid no for me. Sorry, guys.
Stevie?
Oh, this is the hardest of yeses for me. I love dirtbag cinema, especially how most of them end. This is my favorite Adam Sandler movie and performance, bar none.
Got him.
And just, I mean, it's an incredible movie with, you know, we live in an age of nothing but Marvel movies and familiar IP and remakes. And to see something like this so fresh and so aggressive and well-made, you know, top to bottom, the script is awesome. Filmmaking is great. The acting is incredible. And I love that kind of downer ending. You know, I think that's really cool to see in a, you know, very recent movie. So, hardest of yeses.
Josh?
This is Josh from Goshen. I'm obsessed, and I'm going to look up, I'm going to do more research later on how they used fair use for these NBA basketball games. That's awesome.
And write a letter to Universal. explain it to them.
Yeah, this all has to do with Post Malone in the end. But I think, like, Brett is on to something, and one maybe cheap trick they use is the whole movie starts off with a colonoscopy, and like, what at least male human like hasn't dreaded that happening in their life at one point or another. So it's almost like a cheap trick to just get set on this really anxious foot, but it just keeps the foot on the gas. It's brilliant. And one other thing I wanted to give a shout out, when KG is around and he kind of like makes his cameos inside of the jewelry store, I'm sure you guys have all had like little times in your life where you've been around someone famous, but in a movie full of like famous people and even famous directors, like when KG like enters the room, that feeling of like the famous person is here is just like so palpable and real. It's just really great filmmaking. I've drooled over this movie a lot, even maybe more than Kevin Garnett over the Opal itself. So I'll just stop here. But it's a huge Vigo yes for me. I love this movie.
Pap?
Definite hard yes for me too. Like, there's so many great things about this movie, from the way it like makes you feel very, very uncomfortable, to the way that it looks, to like how airtight the script is. Like, now I didn't, we had to work out together like why they didn't get out of the jewelry store, but like when you nitpick this movie, it stands up to scrutiny too, which I think is like it goes into when you have a script for 9 years, you can really refine it and tighten it. Yeah, it's so cool. So cool.
Oh, dude, sorry.
No, I can't not do it. No, I don't know, I love this movie. It's, I think it's really fair that we have one person who vehemently like, hates this movie, because I feel like this movie is definitely not for everyone.
Yeah, production design wise, I think it's amazing. It looks great visually and it sounds amazing. Soundtrack is really great, like we talked about, all the synth. And I think I like have to kind of agree with Brett in the way that it makes you feel throughout the whole movie. Like, you kind of hate watching it, but I don't know. There's just like something when Howard gets shot in the face, it's like all of that tension, all that anxiety in the movie, it's like, ah, this is what it paid off for. It's like, this guy is going to just get blown away at the very end of the movie. So I think it uses that to its advantage in a way that I haven't really seen too many movies do. And it really was a really fun first experience the first time I watched it, but the second time, knowing what happens, it certainly doesn't have the same effect, but yeah, it's still anxiety inducing, and you're just like following Howard and just seeing how this problem he has just fucks up every aspect of his life. And it's just, I don't know. It's like a PSA for gambling, really. And I think it's very effective at it. So I give it a hard yes. I think it's a great movie. I love the Safdie Bros movies. They're so good. And I really can't wait for Corey to win at some point so he can do Good Time, because that's what I really wanted to watch. So
miss you, Corey.
Yeah, it's a hard yes for me.
I haven't seen that. Is it actually not a very good time?
It's a great time.
For Dirtbags. I haven't seen it, so no spoilers, please.
I would say it like invokes the same feelings as this movie, so I'm just probably not gonna watch it. In a criminal space. So what was that? 1, 2, 3, 4 yeses, 1 no?
Yep.
That is
bitter herb.
Fish Howard got the stone delivered in. That's about as fresh as those.
we could have picked something from their little Passover meal or whatever, but that's...
Oh, yeah.
Probably some gefilte fish or matzo ball.
So that's a passing grade for Uncut Gems. You guys ready for trivia?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right. This is just a closest to... nobody has any like real knowledge on diamonds or carrots or any of that shit. So I just figured it'd be pretty even if we just go closest to... How many carats is the largest diamond ever found? And I'm going to need help on the order here because it's just been months since we've done this trivia.
Yeah, I've got you, Mikey. It's been a long time. So you obviously won most recently from Stevie's host, Mouse Hunt, which he won from Corey. We miss you, Corey, on Boondock Saints, who won that from Josh on The Stranger, Brett on The Burbs, and Pappy The Ring. So the order is Stevie, Josh, Brett, Pappy.
And if I win the trivia, there's always a chance it might be a music trivia next episode with the streets involved.
Is that supposed to be like...
So we're hoping you don't win?
It's like a bribe.
Or...
Basically, that's... Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, it's a warning? It's a threat?
The audience is diversified in this matter. I'm sure.
I like the trivia Josh does. I'm just not very good at it.
So Stevie's first?
Sure.
Is that what you're saying, Pap?
Okay. Yep.
Let's go with a queen number. Let's go 390 carats, Alex.
Josh?
Go with a fairly dank 400 and... Wait, what did Stevie say?
390.
420 carats.
Such a dank guess.
Fairly dank.
Me? Oh, man, I have no idea. I'll say 150.
Ugh.
And Pap.
421. I'll take the over.
Actual retail price, and I have no idea. Like the circumference or anything of this thing. But this thing is 3,106 carats.
Wow.
Sky's the limit on carats, boys.
That's fairly dank.
So, Pap, you're the winner. We'll take a quick break. Gather our thoughts here. Pap can choose a movie.
Half off the schneid. Then,
oh my gosh, it's been so long.
Schnicky, yeah, schnicky, we'll schneid.
All right. Break time. Commercial break.
Special thank you to our patrons, Matt Troll.
What do you want? What do you need your bet?
I know. I got to change the bet. I got $21,000 here. So you add it on to the 19 grand. That's $40,000 in all.
Brother Brian.
Scrap the whole bet?
Scrap the whole bet. I want to make a six-way parlay. Celtics Sixers game. What's the lineup?
Still plus one.
Druid King.
Plus one. Okay, so I want the Celtics to cover. I want the Celtics halftime. I want Garnett points and rebounds. Garnett block shots.
Nick.
Celtics opening tip. Do you take lightning bets?
Yeah, but you don't want any part of lightning bets.
Fine.
Come on.
$1,000 a point, okay? Take this.
The Meg.
And this is a gift for me.
What's
this? Just for just tolerating me for all this time, okay?
No. I already have a Rolex. I don't need your watch. Listen, it's probably fell off the truck anyway. Listen,
well, what do you know? Gone at this, gone at that. What do you know?
David.
I don't know. I just know.
Well, I'll tell you what I know. That's the dumbest fucking bet I ever heard of.
Nurse Stacy.
I disagree, Gary.
If you'd like to request an episode, hear your name read by Spoiler Man, or even just help us make podcasts, please check us out on patreon.com/spoilerspodcast.
And we're back. Pap, you're the winner of trivia. What have you chosen?
See, I thought all this time, and I'm going to pivot, actually. I texted Stevie something. I'm going to pick something else.
Oh my gosh.
I just ranked my letterbox list on potential podcast episodes, Pappy, by most popular, to appeal to the widest base of listeners. This is a movie I want to spoil for a while. We're going to go to 1998. Peter Weir directed The Truman Show.
Let's go.
Wow.
Cable TV classic.
I haven't seen that all the way through in probably 15 years.
Yeah, I'm with you there, I think.
If one of us was Truman, which one would it be?
That's going to be my opening question. Save it for the pod.
Fair enough.
Yeah, and for our listeners, if you want to save a penny, don't go there.
Pap, going to host next week with The Truman Show. I hope you guys all liked Uncut Gems. I know we did, besides Brett. Let us know what you think. Like, comment, subscribe, all that shit. Find us on Twitter. Find us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, all that good stuff. Check out our Patreon. Just listen. Just listen to the pods and tell us you're listening.
Smash that like button and subscribe.
Smash that like button. Check out the Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
It's always popping over there. Glad you made it all the way through. Thank you for joining us, and goodbye. We'll see you next week with Pappy's pick of Truman Show. That was spoilers.
I'm gonna come.
Our email is podcastspoilers@gmail.com. Twitter is @spoilers_pod. Our Instagram is Podcast Spoilers. It's lit. Josh Hensley from the Rutabaga wrote our theme song. Please support this podcast by leaving us an iTunes review. To do this, 1. Search for Movie Spoilers. 2. Click on our orange Spoilers Bowl logo and scroll all the way to the bottom. 3. Leave us some stars and some words. Now you can check us out on Spotify, YouTube, Stitcher, Apple, and Google Podcasts. Spoilers is now available on Audible.
Should the Lord of the Rings episodes be just Patreon only?
No. But they can come out after this, I think.
I just want that to be said as a question mark for our audience. They're in such suspense.
Get the people wanting to join the Patreon.
I don't know what to pick.
To see the last chapter through.
I was going to let you guys pick. I had 3 movies to... I'm going to make a folder unless somebody's doing it right now.
Yeah, no, go ahead. Sorry. I don't want to fuck up my pick.
Why? You could just be like Mikey and pick 2 other movies.
Hey, no.
Yeah, pivot.
No, I've never pivoted. Never will.
It's a fun experience.
Always causes controversy. Yeah. Always gets the...
Who has pivoted before?
The thread riled up.
I was the pivot king back in the day.
Josh, speaking of Viggo Mortensen, does he have an uncut gem or...
Hold on. I got to text Stevie something real quick. No,
dude,
sorry.
We used to use uncut gems.
I did. I saw your review. I had no idea what... I was like, oh, okay. I was going to use that joke earlier, but I forgot.
How long ago was that?
Oh my God. I'm just going to do it. Okay.
Pap's ready?
Don't blow it.
Pap, why are you rushing us? We're talking about uncut gems over here.
Why are you... Why do you sound like you're in pain?
I don't know what to... It's been so long. This is scary.
Get your list out.
I'm looking at it.
Pick good time, and then Corey will trade you a couple picks for it.
Oh, yeah.
A couple third-round picks.
Hold it over Corey's head.
To Corey, that's two first-rounders and a third.
Yeah, because everyone loves it when Corey owes Pappy picks and Pappy owes Corey picks. That always...
Fun times for the pod.
Stevie, look at... Can I pick that?
Let me see.
Oh, please. You can't pick riding the bus with your sister.
No, I'm not going to.
Yeah, that'll be a great one.
You think?
Yeah, that's a really good one.
Okay. Yep, I got my pick.
Holy shit, I'm gonna come.
That was spoilers.